In this section, we will study continuous function on so-called compact subsets. And the notion of compactness is a very important one and a very general one, originally coming from topology. But we will not delve into the mathematics too much. We'll just take a very simple definition and work with that one. And we will only consider a special case. But we will see that compact sets somehow have really nice properties and that we have some consequences that that will be useful in what's coming. First of all, we go straight to the definition here. So I'll just give you a straight definition of compactness. We take some subset of R or in C. So in general, I will work everything in C here in this section, but you could again restrict to R everything, it's no problem. Part A, that's something I think I have never really mentioned explicitly. A subset is bounded. Sorry if I may have used this before, I just realized this when I prepared this. If there exists some R bigger than zero, such that the absolute value of X for every X in A is smaller than or equal to this R. So if this for all X in A, then we say the set is bounded. We've only seen bounded sequence so far, but bounded subsets, this is now the official definition, so to say. Okay, part B, we say that a subset is closed if for every convergent sequence in A, so convergent sequence xn in A, so we only know it's convergent, and for every such convergent sequence, it should hold that the limit of the sequence again lies in A. This is something we don't know before. So it's a convergent sequence in the in some subset of R or C, but we don't know about the limit, right? And we demand that the limit always lies inside this set. Finally, we say A is compact if it is closed and bounded. So both of these combined. Okay, so this is quite an abstract definition, so let me just give you some simple examples. I start with the most basic ones, actually. Every closed and bounded interval is closed and bounded in this sense. So it's, I don't write down every closed and bounded interval is closed and bounded. So just every interval of the form A, B in R, so with the boundaries included, A, B in R is compact. Okay, that this is bounded in this sense is obvious because we can just put it into an interval of the form minus RR, so for just R big enough, and this then implies this. The second condition for the closeness, this is something we already know. Namely, we have a sequence in here, and we know, for example, that the sequence is, every element of the sequence is smaller than or equal to B. Then we've seen that the limit is smaller than or equal to B as well. And the same thing in the other direction, so if every element of the sequence is bounded from, is bigger than or equal to A, then the limit will have the same property. This is something we've already seen and used quite some time, so we've already basically already shown that this is closed. Right? So this is the simplest example. Let me give you a non-example, namely, if we take a semi-open interval, let me just take 0, 1 as an example with 0 excluded. This is bounded, obviously, but not closed. We know that, for example, 1 over n is in this in semi-open interval for all n in n. But its limit does not lie in there. But the limit is zero, which is not in this interval. So we have found a sequence which converges, but whose limit is not in there, so it cannot be closed. Just one counterexample destroys it all. Okay, this is bounded but not closed. So let me give you an example of some thing which is closed but not bounded, and this is something which is easy to see. Namely, I just take an interval of this form, an unbounded interval. This is closed but not bounded. It's closed by the same argument as before, as in part one. So if every element of a sequence is bigger than or equal to A, then the limit has the same property, and that this is not bounded is clear, because this contains very, very large numbers, as large as we want, so we cannot find such a capital R which bounds everything. So this kind of, yeah, destroys the boundedness here. Okay, now I want to give you a more sophisticated example, and so because it's a bit longer to show this, I mean, it's actually not very hard, but I make this an own theorem for an important class of examples, namely the following. Let Z0 be a complex number and R be a positive number. Then the following set, dr of z0, which is defined as the following. We take the set of all z in C such that the absolute value of z minus z0 is smaller than or equal to r. Then this set is compact. Okay, now if you understand the complex numbers quite well, then you will see what this is geometrically. Geometrically, if we have some, so let's say this is C, and we have some point z0, which is somewhere in C. Okay, we now have all points with z minus z0 to the absolute value is smaller than or equal to r. This difference here, this is basically the distance of z to z0. So everything such that this difference here, we have seen that, or we've discussed that the absolute value of a complex number is its length as a vector in R2. So everything which is such that the difference vector of this two has length smaller than or equal to r. And this is geometrically just a circle. This is a circle around z0 of radius r. So the whole circle here, so everything the inside and the boundary circle here, this together, this is dr of z0. This is the set we want to study. And I claim that this is compact. Okay, and this is not that hard to see. So just a bit, just for a change, a quite simple proof, so it may be quite relaxing. First of all, we show the boundedness. And for this, we basically only need the our good old friend, the triangle inequality. We need to find some capital R such that this property holds, and we can define our capital R explicitly as little r plus the absolute value of z0, which is of course a fixed point. Then, for all z in this circle, you know, in this disk is something you call this often a disk, closed disk. Around z0. For all of these z in there, we get that the absolute value of z, this should be bounded from above by r, and we just do the old trick with the triangle inequality, where we just subtract z0 and add it again, and then it's smaller than or equal to z minus z0 plus the absolute value of z0. By construction, this lies in this disk, so this is smaller than or equal to r plus z0 to the absolute value, and I've just defined r in this way such that this follows. So this directly implies that dr of z0 is bounded. Okay, what about the closeness? This is also not too hard to see. Closed. Okay, let xn be a sequence in this disk. Sequence in dr of z0 such that it converges, and I will call the limit x0, so with limit n to infinity xn is equal to x0. This is just some complex number that we don't know about yet. And we need to show that this limit then lies in this disk. So this is now kind of very technical. So we need to show that this x0 satisfies this condition that defines this disk, so that this inequality here is satisfied if we enter x0 here instead of z. So this is now very technical. Then we know that this converges, so we know that the limit of xn minus z0 is x0 minus z0. This is just adding a constant sequence and using the limit arguments. And now we've seen that the absolute value is continuous. We've seen this was example 3, 9, one, that the absolute value of something is continuous, and the continuity then means that the limit of this sequence, xn minus z0 to the absolute value, that this then has to be the function here, so the value of the limit, and this means this is x0 minus x0, z0 to the absolute, to the absolute value. So since, and now the same argument that we used multiple times already, this thing here is by assumption smaller than r for all n in n, then we get that the limit of the sequence is the same property. So there we get that x0 minus z0 to the absolute value is smaller than r, and this is just the defining inequality for our disk. So this shows that x0 is in dr of z0, which shows that it's bounded. Right? So this is actually easy to see. Just geometrically for the boundedness, if we have this picture, we just need to show that some R exists with this property. You can just imagine we just need a very big disk here. We need just a big circle which goes somewhere around here, which has radius capital R. This would be capital R. So, Sasha, this is included. So we just need to make it big enough, but here we always can find such a radius because at some point we have included everything. That's the idea here. Okay, so the first thing about compact sets that we will study, or about continuous functions on compact sets, and this is a property which does not look very spectacular, but it's very, very helpful, we will draw an interesting consequence of this. Let K be subset of R or K subset of C be compact. And let F from K to C be continuous. Then the image F of capital K is compact. Okay, great. The first thing we learned about compact sets is something about compact sets. Okay, does not look very interesting, but this is really a crucial thing. And we will just keep your patience, and I will prove this and then give you a nice consequence of this set that we shall use frequently. Okay, how to prove this? Of course, we need, again, sequences. So first, we need to show that this is closed and bounded, and I will start with closedness. So we take a convergent sequence, yn, be a convergent sequence in F of K. So we need to show that this limit again lies in F of K. So we know that, so by definition, since this is just the image, this means that we can find a sequence in K, xn be a sequence in K, just some sequence, with f of xn equal to yn for every n in n. So we just take a pre-image sequence, so to say. Okay, we don't know anything about the sequence at the moment, but we can now use the compactness because K is bounded, which especially implies that every sequence in this set is bounded. This is also easy to see just by a definition of boundedness. K is bounded, which implies that xn is bounded. And here we go with Bolzano-Weierstrass. This is bounded. So here again, Bolzano-Weierstrass, let me just use this really quick abbreviation. We have a convergent subsequence. There exists a convergent subsequence of these pre-images. X in K, K in N. There exists a convergent subsequence. Okay, I got to erase. Okay, we've now used the boundedness of the set K to get a convergent sequence of this pre-image sequence. And now we can use the closedness. So now it's the second part of compactness kicking in. Since K is closed, we get that the limit of this convergent subsequence, limit of x and K, lies in K. Okay, so much for that. I want to give this a name. This point, sorry, this is called x0 again. So this is the limit of this pre-image subsequence in some sense. So now we can only use the continuity since f is continuous. It follows that the limit from, so we know, remember we started with a convergence sequence yn. Okay, the limit of the sequence is now the limit of every subsequence. So in particular, it's the limit of k going to infinity of ynk. This is by definition the limit of k to infinity of f of xnk. Okay, and if this goes to some element x0 of k, we know by continuity of f that this is f of x0. And in particular, since x0 is in k, this is in f of k. And this is what we wanted to show. The limit of this original sequence is in f of k. So this implies that f of k is closed. Okay, now boundedness is still missing. Suppose we do this by contradiction. Suppose f of k is not bounded. So we cannot find such a value r such that the absolute value of every point in f of k is smaller than r. This means kind of we can find points in here whose absolute value becomes as big as we want. In particular, we can find for each n and n, we can find some element, which I'll call zn to give it a change, in f of k with absolute value of zn is bigger than or equal to n. Okay, they can just become big, big, big. This is the crucial thing here. Okay, now, this is a sequence in f of k. So again, we have a pre-image sequence, and this we want to call wn. Wn be a sequence in k. With f of wn equal to zn for every n in n. Okay, and now we can use the same argument as we did in the previous step. This is a sequence in this bounded set k and closed and bounded set. So by the same argument, we get a convergent subsequence. As before, get a convergent subsequence. Sequence wnk. K in n, okay, such that the limit lies in k, but this is not relevant at the moment. So wnk convergent subsequence. So, whose limit is in k, we still need this, yeah, sorry. But then we get that again by continuity. So f is continuous. The sequence f of wnk must converge as well. But by construction of these w's, this is the same as znk converges. In f of k, but this is not really important here. So this converges, but this can't converge. This is a contradiction. Znk cannot converge because it's unbounded. Because it is unbounded. And this was just by construction of the sequence. We have that znk is bigger than or equal to nk for all k in n. And as k goes to infinity, this goes to infinity. So this gives us really that this sequence of these absolute values must diverge to infinity. And so this cannot converge. So we have our contradiction. And so this shows that f of k is bounded. And so we've shown both parts. And so we've shown the compactness. Okay, so images of compact sets under continuous functions are continuous. This is also something that you should kind of always keep in your mind because this is really useful quite often. And now I want to apply this to a special case, namely to functions with real values. So which not go to z but to r. And we can now namely discuss something that you usually do in high school over and over, namely the minima and maxima of a function. Usually when I when there's a first year student like you are, most of them you have kind of automatic procedure from high school in mind. You get a function, you should search for minima and maxima, so you build the derivative, you have to find the zeros of the derivative and go on and on and on. So doing this, but yeah, why is there such a minimum and maximum? So of course in the examples in high school or something that you get, you always have these values, but why is there a maximum and a minimum? In general, I mean this, since we rebuild everything from scratch axiomatically, we first need to show that there is a maximum and minimum before we start searching for them. So does it even make sense? And here the compactness is kicking in. Namely, compactness guarantees the existence of maxima and minima, as we shall see. But first I will give the formal technical definition of maximum and minimum. Okay, so we let D subset of C and we take a function from D to R. Okay, first difference to high school, the domain might be a subset of C and not just an R. It's only important that the values of F are an R, right? This is to define the minimum and maximum, we just need real values. Okay, first of all, M in R, so some real number capital M, is called the maximum of F. And I'll give an explicit definition, which you will all agree with that this is the right one. A maximum of F, and we denote it by just max F, if, what do we need for the maximum? We need that this dominates everything, so all hail value M, everything is smaller than or equal to M, for all X in D. And there is really a point in this set D where we have this value. So there exists some x0 in D with f of x0 is equal to m. Okay, this is the definition of a maximum, all hail the king, and so there the king exists. And the same for minimum. But the, for the minimum we get basically the same thing with reverse inequalities. Just some more terminology, sorry. We then say that if there is such a point and you have this maximum, in this situation that F attains its maximum at this point x0, and we call x0 a maximum point. So if we talk about, that's one of the most common mistakes, when I talk about the minimum, I really mean the number, the value that comes out. So x0, a maximum point of f. Okay, and now you can all imagine what happens for the minimum, basically everything with reverse inequalities. A value which I call small m, in R is the minimum of f denoted by min f equal to m. Okay, now I have to do everything again, and since this is very relaxing for you, I will put some relaxing music underneath starting now. Okay, so if f of x is bigger than or equal to small m for all x in D, and if there exists a point where really this value is taken, so if there exists an x0 in the domain with f of x0 is m. And in this case, we can do this again. We say that f attains its minimum at x0. And you can guess what's coming now. We call x0 a minimum point. For f. Okay. Right. Okay, the relaxing part is over. And we reformulate this again in hard mathematics, actually, and we kind of give the connection to what we did before. Remark 331. First of all, as I've already indicated, not every function has a minimum or maximum. So not every f has a maximum or minimum. Now, a very profane example. I take f from the open interval 0, 1 to r, f of x equal to x. Okay, this goes between 0 and 1, but the important points, 0 and 1, which would be the biggest and the lowest, are missing. So this has neither of the two. And second thing, so about something being very big and close to the set and so on, there is a connection to the terms of supremum and infimum that we've already seen. So f possesses a maximum, or I just write in parentheses always the minimum case, so it's of course analogous, if and only if the supremum of f of d lies in, so supremum of this set here lies in f of d. Then, yeah, and the same thing for the minimum if the infimum has this property. So the infimum of this set, and if you think about the definition of this minimum, of course, then just by definition, this is an upper bound, and this has to be the smallest upper bound or lower bound in the infimum case, because we have some point where it's realized. So it's just basically by combining this with the previous definition we know, and then we immediately get this here, that this holds. And in this case, the maximum of f is, of course, the supremum of f of d, or in the minimum case, the minimum of f is the infimum of the set f of d. Okay. This is really not that hard. You just have to kind of, basically it's something you have to write down and meditate about these terms a bit, and then you immediately see that this is the same. So there's the connection between supremum, infimum, and maximum and minimum that you might be more comfortable with. Okay, yeah, let me quickly erase. Okay, now I will prove the theorem that I've been mentioning before. So theorem 332. We take a compact subset of C and a continuous function on K with values in R. Be continuous, then F possesses a minimum, a maximum and a minimum. Oh, maximum and a minimum. Okay, why is that? So first of all, this is really important because this guarantees that if we have some continuous map on some closed bounded interval as a real function now, so a real function on an interval, we just always get a maximum and a minimum. So this kind of searching for maximum minimum that you're kind of trained with using derivatives and so on, this really works. This is now the precise reason for this being a reasonable question to search for maximum and minimum in this case. So by this previous remark, so we need to show by remark 331, part two, that the sup and the inf are included. So that sup of f of k and the inf of f of k are again contained in f of k. This is what we need. Okay, so to save some notation, we put A to be f of k. Okay, now first we can use the theorem which looked quite unspectacular before, namely that the image of this is again compact. So by theorem 329, A is compact. Images of compact subsets under continuous maps are compact. Okay, this is compact, but what does this mean? Or what does this help us? First of all, we know that A is bounded. So this gives us that sup and inf are actually, sup of A and inf A are real numbers. So this makes sense. There's nothing going to infinity or anything, which could happen otherwise. Of course, if there's some arbitrary function, it could go to infinity or minus infinity, and then we don't need to search for maximum minimum because we can get very big or very small. So yeah, this doesn't really help us. So here we know by compactness, by this boundedness condition, these are so there's only a finite range, finite interval range worth of values. Okay, so it's bounded. Now, by definition of this, this makes sense. And so by definition of this, of the supremum, and this is now an argument that we've already used sometimes in the proofs, we can find for each n, n and n, there exists an element xn, an element of A, with sup A minus 1 over n is smaller than or equal to, strictly smaller, I want even, xn smaller than or equal to sup A, because this is not a lower bound for A, an upper bound for A, since sup A is the smallest upper bound. Okay, standard argument. So, by the squeeze theorem, if we can now construct such a sequence, so we can apply the squeeze theorem to such a sequence xn that we obtain this way. So we know that this goes to A, obviously. This goes to supremum of A, obviously. This is constant supremum of A, so the limit n to infinity of xn is the supremum of A. Okay, but now we're done, because now we can use the second part, namely that A is closed. And now we know this is the limit of a sequence in A, so this implies sup A in A. So just recall, this was notation. This is sup f of k is in f of k. And so by this argument before, this shows that it has a maximum. And of course, analogously, we can do this with inf, because we show inf A in A. And so we get that the maximum of F is indeed given as the supremum of A, and the minimum of F is the infimum of A. This completes the proof. Okay, some remarks on this theorem. So we have some preconditions. We have assumed that F is continuous, and that K is closed, and that K is bounded. And for this existence of a maximum minimum, you cannot really drop one of them. You really need them all. And I will give you counterexamples for cases where just two of them are satisfied. So remark 333. So in theorem 332, first of all, K closed is necessary for the existence of min, max, and min. Necessary. And the example is the one from remark 331. This was just a continuous map on an open interval which didn't have maximum and minimum. Although the interval is bounded, so it's just this closed condition missing. So there we have already a counterexample. So now, why is K bounded necessary? So can we find a closed interval and a continuous function on this interval which doesn't have maximum and minimum? And the answer is, of course, yes. Otherwise, I wouldn't have announced it so bigly. We take the interval from 0 to plus infinity, which is obviously unbounded, but it's closed, right? So this is a closed interval. And it takes values in R, and namely the following. F of x is x divided by x plus 1. Okay, what happens here? We see that if x is becoming bigger and bigger, of course, we will make this precise later, so just heuristically at the moment. If x is becoming bigger and bigger, these two are approaching each other, so this fraction here is approaching 1.
But we will never reach one because this is always smaller than the denominator. So this will always be some number below one. So the graph would look somehow like this. If we have, say here, zero, and so at zero we start at the point zero, but then we approach this one. So if I draw a horizontal line here at height one, the graph would be something like this. So approaching and approaching and approaching and yeah, never reaching. So this means that we don't have a maximum because we approach one, and but we can run as fast as we want, we will never reach it. So this maximum is not obtained. So here, here, 0 to plus infinity is closed. F is continuous because this is a product of the continuous function x with 1 over x plus 1, and 1 over x plus 1 is continuous because reciprocs of continuous function are continuous functions are continuous in this case. So and here this is continuous, but the supremum, using this argument from before, the supremum of f of 0 to plus infinity, so the supremum of the image is 1, and this is nowhere attained. So f does not have maximum. This has a minimum because we start at 0 here, so but this does not have a maximum. Okay, third example, continuity is necessary, and here I'm now doing something very profane, so to say, a very simple example. F continuous is necessary. So we now take a compact interval, but a function which is not continuous. So f goes from minus 1, 1 to r. F of x is, and now case-wise, either it's the absolute value of x if x is non-zero. And so just to give you already the intuition about this, so the absolute value, this means that here we, for non-negative numbers, it's just x, and here it's just minus x, so kind of flipping the direction here, so it's going like this. This would be the graph. So we would see is, of course, yeah, this has maximum because we start at minus 1 and go to 1, and the minimum would be here. But now we'd simply destroy it. We simply say, no, this minimum we don't want. We just say at 0, we just define this function to be 1. So quite ugly. So here, we leave out this value and just put it to some value 1. So here it's this. So we just manually remove this minimum, and okay, now we have a function which is not continuous. We've destroyed continuity here because we have this jump here at 0, but it doesn't have a minimum. So minus 1, 1 is compact, but the minimum, min f, does not exist. Okay, so much for this theorem. There is one more property of continuous functions that I just want to mention, and this is really not that important, and I will not prove it here explicitly. I will give a proof in the lecture notes anyway, so you'll find it if you want, you can read it up. Namely, it's again about the continuity of inverses. We've seen that there are quite some difficulties. We had this for intervals, it was fine. If the domain was not an interval, then we run into problems, as we've seen in this example, but in the compact case, it's also fine. Namely, there's a theorem saying if K is a subset of C is compact, and F from K to C is continuous and injective, then it follows that the inverse, which is then again defined if we take this on the codomains, on the image of F to K, is continuous. So here we've got the situation again. Again, this theorem is not important. I will not really use it very much. I'll just maybe quickly mention it at some point, but this is something, this is a condition where compactness is also useful to guarantee the continuity of inverses. And the proof of this, as I said, you find it in the lecture notes. So you can read it up there. Okay, so there's more about compact functions that I will tell you, but since I now have to leave this room, we will see this in the next video.